electric snowmobiles. Remember that? The company's gone bankrupt. The Canadian government was really touting these as like the future clean tech and snowmobile technology or whatever. And it's gone under. Ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. Waste of tax dollars, waste of time, waste of money, waste of energy. These people are stealing from us. There's lots to get to. Let's get to it. First, we have to start off at affordability and the food professor, and he's highlighting the how much things have gone up or things have dropped in Canada. The first tweet is price increases, of course. What's more expensive? I make pita, which is just a circular like cheese pie, pita. It's a feta cheese and butter wrapped in a phyllo pastry and then done in a big circle. And I make that at home. That's what my grandmother used to do for New Year's, and I still do it. And you go through a lot of olive oil when you're making pita because there's a lot of olive oil in pita. And I noticed this price increase. So the first price is olive oil up 44%. 44%. Holy smoke. Sugar is up 21%. Infant formula is up 17%. Remember when they were just destroying the infant formula? I remember showing a clip of a woman who was driving a truck and taking a video of them dropping off these loads to be destroyed. And I thought, man, that's pretty wild. But this was years ago. So 17% increase, but it's very expensive now. Orange juice up 15%. Chicken drumsticks up 14%. Cucumbers 14%. Grapes 13%. Tomatoes 13%. Onions 13%. Ground beef 10%. Mushrooms 10%. And butter 9%. Butter is ridiculous. Butter used to be $3 and now it is pushing $7 or $8. And I do my best to buy it cheap, but still, like $5 for a pound of butter is a lot of money for a pound of butter. The biggest price drops in Canada over the past year. Weird that orange juice has increased, but oranges have decreased. Oranges down 27%. Broccoli, they're just giving it away, 20% reduction. Celery, here you go. Would you like some celery in your chili? Down 13%. Apples are down 13%. Apples, I used to eat an apple every morning, not because of the old apple a day, blah, blah, just because I liked Royal Gala apples, but they have to be crunchy. And at a certain point, to get good crunchy Gala apples was like $8 or $9 for a 3-pound bag. And I thought to myself, this is crazy. And so now I eat grapes, which is still expensive, but I eat all the grapes. I eat all the apples too. But sometimes, especially in the wintertime, the apples were mushy and completely unedible. Pasta's down 17%. Potatoes are down 12%. Canned tuna's down 12%. Chicken breasts down 11%. Baked beans down 11%. Limes down 11%. Canned peaches down 10%. And wheat flour's down 9%. So the affordability thing is interesting. The grocery stores are being maligned as profiteering monsters, while Jagmeet Singh and Justin Trudeau are increasing the carbon tax and giving themselves a raise. And it's really interesting going into the grocery stores. Like, it's expensive, but some things are cheaper than you think, or even cheaper than you remember. And other things are wildly more expensive. Like, I didn't realize how expensive olive oil was. And I was looking at the prices of olive oil. I thought there was one the other week, $7 for a big bottle. And I thought, oh man, that's cheap. And it was on sale, right? And now I went when I needed it and it was very expensive. And I thought, jeepers creepers, when did that happen? So it happens very sneakily, but also the grocery stores seem to be dropping prices on some things while increasing prices on other things. And it's an interesting shell game that they're playing with the consumer while at the same time having bad policies to deal with, because it is bad policies. It's out of their control. Although at the same time, at some point you have to say no to these crazy people. Like, at some point we are going to have to say no to these crazy people. Janet is highlighting this 129% increase in business bankruptcies. She says, why is this not headline news in all of Canadian media? StatsCan reports so far unreported. And it says the total number of insolvencies in January 24 was 27.4% higher than the total number of insolvencies in January 23. Consumer insolvencies increased by 23.5%, while business insolvencies increased by 129.3%. And she says, my speech at the Ottawa carbon tax rally on April 1st, the carbon tax is bad policy for farmers and our food supply chain. Business bankruptcies increased by 129%, according to StatsCan. Did you know that? Have you heard that reported anywhere? Only if you listen to Canada Poly. So people are struggling. Businesses are struggling. Businesses are just people who've figured out a way to offer their business or service at a rate people will pay for it, right? And that's great when they figure it out. But when all of a sudden you're on the hook for thousands of dollars in carbon tax, or the carbon tax to heat your barn makes it not profitable to have so many chickens, or whatever it is, then all of a sudden your business is not viable. You can't employ anybody. You can't make money to sustain yourself, and you're more reliant on the state, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that's a bad policy. That's a bad way to run the country. And these liberals are doubling and tripling down on these bad policies. This girl is talking for 2 minutes, and she says the price of living is astronomical. She lives in a dorm and utilities are paid. I still have moments where I wasn't able to afford food. I was going to the dollar store to buy snacks and I couldn't afford food at one point. So it's dire for everybody, even living in a dorm. Now, this kind of stuff, it sounds almost professional. This guy's got a voice for radio, right? Like, I've listened to Tarzan Dan do this kind of voice. I went to Niagara College back when I was a young lad, and there was radio broadcasting as there was a whole dorm of radio broadcast people, and they would all put on this voice and they'd try and out radio broadcast each other. And sometimes they'd do mass calls in the residence, because I lived in residence, and it was always one of these guys doing this voice. This kind of stuff is going to be used, and I'm just showing it as an example of, and I mean, I don't know who this is. It kind of looks like Rance Derrick, but it's not Rance Derrick. He's advocating for violence. I'm not advocating for violence, but I don't know that there's a political solution. But this kind of stuff will be cited by the government as a credible threat. And they use that, and then I'll show you in the next series of tabs, they use that to meaningfully change their operating procedures to limit transparency and our ability to hold police officers accountable. So I don't agree with doing this kind of stuff. People can say what they want, et cetera, but this guy putting this out there is not helpful. And again, I'm showing this as an example of things that that the government and the police will use to justify further crackdowns. Okay, so here, I don't know if it's loud. We'll turn it down a little bit to start. Here we go.
Carbon tax, increase in GST, funding endless wars in Israel and the Ukraine, and almost zero funding for our own borders, and threat to World War III and another bullshit pandemic while we watch our cities being intentionally funded with illegal migrants paid for with our tax dollars as we try to figure out how to pay our own goddamn bills while our politicians are importing a new voter base and then give themselves a new fucking raise. Canadians are getting fucked. And these pricks aren't even trying to hide it anymore. Just look at Christina Friedlander, Castro Jr.'s face when asked a question. They don't even give you a goddamn answer. The only people they answer to is the WEF. Look, at some point, we're all going to have to stand up and say enough is enough. At some point, Canada Strong is going to have to wake up and kick Canada's...
So just to be clear, up until that point, you're probably nodding along, right? I was like, okay, this guy's enthusiastic and he's got his, you know, rocking music in the background. He's doing his radio voice, right? And I thought, that at this point, he's like, now we have to kick their asses. And he starts advocating for violence. And it's like, man, why? I know that this is a very difficult problem to fix. And I understand that a political solution is not likely. Fine. They're going to use this against people who want to reestablish freedom and self-governance.
Because peacefully protesting isn't working anymore. Look, the only way a government runs properly is when it fears its populace. We don't have political leaders anymore. Now we have self-styled elitists. Political leaders that deem half of its citizens as racist and misogynistic. Political overlords that write bills criminalizing.
I don't know that the leadership needs to fear the population. I wouldn't want to govern a place where I feared the population. I would fear consequences of my actions in the court. I would fear if I was doing something like telling people experimental injection was safe and effective. I'd say, how do I know that it's safe and effective? I don't know that it's safe and effective. You're telling me, but how do I know you know? And so on, right? Like, I would doing that, I would fear the backlash from the residents that I was trying to govern. Flooding the country with illegal migrants and then getting my taxpayer base to pay for it. Again, I don't know that I would be worried that Canadians would show up at my door with a pitchfork, but maybe I'd be arrested and then charged for that. That's what we should fear, that everybody is being held to the same legal standard. And if you commit treason, that you're going to have consequences for that. And people will find out because transparency is paramount and so on and so forth. I don't know that I want to run a place, or I don't know that I want to live in a place where roving mobs of angry people show up periodically, because I mean, like, you could rally some people to do that. I've seen Beauty and the Beast, right? Let's go kill the beast. Is that the best way to deal with this? Probably not, right? And so, like, man, it's a situation where I understand the passion, I understand the anger, but I am suspicious. I've got suspicious eyebrows here, because he's saying, you know, we've got to make sure those politicians fear us. And I think that we should have laws that make it so if the politician is messing around, then they're going to have a lot of problems with the law. If you commit treason, we're going to arrest you. and we're going to really make it uncomfortable for you. Like, don't you dare. But at this point, like, people are committing treason, and it's not like that's like a Tuesday, right? Like, here's Jagmeet Singh talking about how carbon taxes, if Galen Weston continues making profits, then he's going to pay more profit taxes, more excess profit taxes. The only way to fix the affordability problem, higher taxes, and increase immigration, right? There you go. Jagmeet Singh's got the solution. Here's Jagmeet Singh. This is just in it's 2 minutes. So we're just listening to the last 45 seconds or so. Here we go.
And what is well and above that, we would consider excess profits. There are other countries that have done so. They've used different ways.
Hold on. We have to back it up. She asks him, how do you gauge what excess profits is? And he says, you know, we take what they've earned. We take what they've earned, and then we compare it from last year to this year. And if it's over and above what we think is reasonable, that's excess profits. Super, super scientific technique. Okay, so that's what she's asking here.
You're tackling here. What exactly do you define as an excess profit?
Yeah, so we looked at different ways of addressing excess profits, because it is, you know, interesting. How do you determine what's an excess profit? Mm-hmm. Well, we look at previous years and the average of what a company has made, factor in some growth, and what is well and above that, we would consider excess profits. There are other countries that have done so. They've used different ways, different mechanisms of addressing it. But ultimately, we want to get at the fact that if corporate grocery stores like the Loblaw, Sobeys, and Metro...
He did not answer the question. You know, we look at what they made, and then we factor in some growth things. You know, other people have done this using different methods. But really, what we want to talk about is this. He did not answer the question. What's your methodology? Oh, you know.
Which are making record profits while people can't buy groceries, there's something wrong with that picture. We want to go after that problem. And so our plan is, let's put in an excess profit tax on those companies. Let's go after that greed and reinvest the revenue that we get from that back into people.
Are you worried at all that increasing the tax, they'll pass that on to consumers, that grocery prices may end up going up for the everyday person there?
Well, the way it would work is if they continue to increase their profits, then they're going to have to continue to pay even more of an excess profit tax.
Yeah, super great solution, Jagmeet. Unreal, right? Like, this is he's saying things like, when I'm prime minister, unironically, like, he's trying to convince people to vote for him for that. Ha, are you kidding? I mean, really, honestly. So Jagmeet Singh swings and a miss. The whole taxing people to help make things more affordable, that's a dumb plan. It's just a dumb plan. There's no more color needed. Okay, here's how are the police acting when you look at very violent protests that shut down highways and target specific neighborhoods in Toronto, et cetera, while the police show up with coffee for those guys, right? However, in Alberta or Saskatchewan, the RCMP show up, they remove their badges, they have guns drawn and sidearms holstered at the Axe the Tax rally. Isn't that weird? Isn't that a strange juxtaposition? Wouldn't you expect police to show up with coffee for the Axe the Tax protesters? Very interesting indeed. Here are the RCMP didn't realize they were showing up to a meme fight, and they came completely unarmed. So these guys are walking around. I don't know why they're walking around. It kind of reminds me of Patriot Front. And there's a video of them marching in a circle. Where is it? Hold on a second, I'll find it. Here it is. They're walking in a circle. I don't know why they're walking in a circle here. I don't understand the context going on or anything like that. They're just walking around in a big circle. It's not to make crop circles. I don't know what they're doing. I have no idea. Why are you walking around in a big circle, guys? So I don't know why the cops are walking around in a circle. That's a great song. But they're doing a show of intimidation, and they're trying to be super tough. And Canadians find this hilarious because Canadians understand their rights under the law, I guess. And if they were abiding by the law, the Canadians would have those rights. And so they're acting, the Canadians are acting as if they have those rights. And so they're making fun of these cops, and the cops hate it. But here's some Canadians memeing away, pointing their finger and laughing very hard at these idiot cops. Here we go.
Hey,
trolling in real life, right? And they're playing an SS marching song, I guess. It sounds very, German. And Amazing Zoltan says, day three of the carbon tax protest, how many more days to go? So now we're in day four. Are they protesting again today? So this is footage from day three. If you're interested in that, that's part of the cops walking in a circle. Here's another bit of footage from day three. A woman saying, we'd like to know who you are, officer. And they do not respond. Here we go.
Can I get your badge number? Can I get your name? Do you speak English? Would you like to come talk to us? Somebody here can come talk to us? Do you have a name? Do you have a badge number? Do you speak English? Are you from here? Nobody wants to talk to us.
Who's taking the coffee orders? So you get the picture, right? So why are the police doing that? Why are they allowed to do that? I thought it was against the law to do that. I still think it's against the law to do that. Roughneck says, deadbeat globalist premier Danielle Smith sits idle while Trudeau's SS Gestapo harass and intimidate citizens. She raised fuel tax 13% and stands by while the federal government increases the fake carbon tax by 23%. Redman and Kenny left over. What's your game, Danielle Smith? Honestly, here's 22 hours ago, Alberta Premier Danielle Smith doubles down on her signature Alberta model of recovery-oriented care. We're going to talk about healthcare in Kent and Alberta specifically in a minute. Here is me saying this is against the law, and Matt responds. He says, this is what Big Al had to say. And basically, it says, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police has policies regarding the disclosure of officers' names and badge numbers. However, these policies can vary depending on the situation. For instance, during the Freedom Convoy protests, the RCMP refused to release the badge numbers of officers who cleared protesters from the Ambassador Bridge, citing a risk of violence from their supporters. This decision was made due to concerns about the safety of the officers. It's important to note that this was an exceptional case involving clear, credible threats. Normally, the disclosure of badge numbers is seen as part of the RCMP's commitment to transparency. However, in situations where there is a perceived risk to safety of personnel, the RCMP may choose to withhold this information. Please note that this information is based on specific past events and the RCMP's decision in those contexts. The policies may vary depending on the situation and location. For the most accurate information, it would be best to directly contact the RCMP or a legal professional. Yeah, right. But that's the claim, right? Here's CTV News. This is from October 22. Mendocino concerned the RCMP withheld badge numbers of officers who cleared the protest. So are the officers showing up here and not responding to the people and removing their badge numbers a response because they feel there's a credible threat? How do we know? How can we tell? Why are they allowed to do that and engage with people or stand there, film people, have weapons drawn, and not say anything? Why is that okay? Here's what Marco Mendocino had to say in the CTV report. Public Safety Minister Mendocino says he's concerned the RCMP chose not to release the badge numbers of officers who cleared the Freedom Convoy protest from the Ambassador Bridge last winter. The RCMP denied an access to information request for officers' names and badge numbers on the basis of releasing the information could put officers' safety at risk. So now they're preemptively going to protest, not identifying themselves, arming themselves against Canadian citizens. That's bad. Very bad. The Canadian press obtained a briefing note to Commissioner Brenda Luckey on the matter, which included an intelligence report showing that senior Mounties feared officers could be doxxed by convoy supporters if they were identified. They're police officers, and doxxing is something that happens online when somebody's done something on an anonymous account. If you're acting in your role as a police officer and you do something that the public doesn't like, the public has a right to hold you accountable. What? Doxxing people? Are you joking? They're not joking. Holy cow. She was asked to approve the decision because it raised questions around transparency. Quote, I'm very concerned by that report, Mendocino said in a recent interview visiting Saskatchewan to discuss. I thought there was a place called Saskatchewan, and I was like, where is that? We really like Toronto and Saskatchewan. Saskatchewan. To discuss policing on First Nations. Obviously, badges and names are there in the interest of transparency, and we'll have more to say about that, but they never did. Mendicino said the matter underlines the importance of government legislation tabled last spring, which he says would provide more robust civilian oversight of the RCMP. Fast forward 2 years, and it's worse than it was before. Yay! The Liberals failing on every measure. Here's Global News for the same report. So that's pretty wild. And in Saskatchewan, Highway 1 near the Saskatchewan-Manitoba border, it's being blocked by the RCMP, according to Desi Media. So this guy's got, he's showing the police officers blocking the road here. And then there's a second one here. And like there's a second display of the same on the other side here. Okay. And so that's pretty wild. Why are the police blockading Highway 1 on the border of Manitoba and Saskatchewan? What's going on? Right. And what's going on? April 8th is coming. Every disaster. I mean, I can't even remember what the last disaster tent pole was. There was a day and I've said, I think it was like the 23rd or something like that. And I thought something, it'd be interesting if that happens, but probably not. And I said, probably not. Don't hold your breath. And then I think I forgot about it on the 23rd. And like 3 days later, I thought, guess nothing happened. But it's stuff like you wake up and you see the Little Palestine or something Palestine, Ohio, and you see that kind of disaster and it gets buried, right? Or you wake up and you see the bridge disaster and it gets buried. You don't get, it's not like 4 days from now something bad's going to happen and then the bridge blows up. Maybe. Sometimes those things happen. Not all the time. But is that coincidence or was it a warning? That 4chan guy, was that 4chan guy being legit? Who knows, right? All right, let's move on. Talk about CO2 because the affordability crisis is a problem. It's caused by the carbon tax. The carbon tax causes protesters. The protesters cause the police to behave in a way that is very military-like, especially it seems very foreign military-like, but it all comes down to the carbon tax. And that has to do with regular everyday people just not being able to get by. And learned people like the food professor and others, people who have been operating in our economy when we understood how we could feed ourselves, have been saying all of your policies are bad and they're causing all of these problems. Now, Jagmeet Singh hears that and he hears Galen Weston's bad and he's stealing from us. And so he does nothing to fix the carbon tax. But the food professor is being very clear. He says, my open letter addressing Canada's carbon tax policy, proponents of the carbon tax academic open letter argue that Canada needs national standards to prevent a competitive race to the bottom among provinces. However, in the context of food, this assumption is dangerous. The climate does not recognize geopolitical boundaries, and if the business climate becomes less favorable, agri-food enterprises may move outside of Canadian borders. These advocates also claim they are open to alternatives policies superior to the carbon tax, provided there is empirical evidence to support them. Yet Canadians are still waiting for comprehensive mathematical justification for the current policy. This draws an interesting point. So Justin Trudeau told the premiers, if you can come up with a better, cheaper policy, then we'll use your idea. But he has not proven his is what it says, what he says it is. He hasn't proven mathematically that the carbon tax brings down emissions. He hasn't proven mathematically that what he's doing is the correct move or anything to that effect. And yet he's demanding that in order to not do his unproven method, you have to prove yours. And I think that that's an impossible standard, right? Like, I think, you know, Jim Crow era, you'd like, sure, you can vote, Mr. Person who I don't like because of whatever immutable characteristic you possess. But first you have to pass this exam that I'm setting and I mark as well. It's an impossible standard. Right. And I think that that's what the situation we're in right now. We're being tasked with go find me a shrubbery. Right. Like it's a red herring. We're off on a side quest when we should be dealing with the problem here. Make no mistake, continues the food professor, and I disagree with him here. The climate change poses the most significant challenge to our agri-food sector, and action is necessary. I think if we remove the communists and stop the spraying in the skies, we'd have a massive improvement to the climate. As such, he says it's important to recognize that the agri-food industry is already making significant efforts to reduce its carbon footprint. But given Canada's abundant natural resources, the nation should lead in establishing a global carbon market mechanism rather than restricting its people and agri-food industry. Sure, I could get on board with leading in agri-food, but I don't want to get on board with the idea that we need to modify what we're doing in order to Reality can only be ignored for so long, says this economist, and Dan McTeague's highlighting this. He says, sounds familiar. Finally, the lobbyists in Ottawa are flying into reality and realizing that we can't be the world's climate punching bag, as the Liberals, New Democrats, and Green grifters have encouraged. And so this is just a part he's talking about how, well, the reality of the situation is making itself apparent because you can only just ignore it for so long. And now the government's realizing they can't ignore it and it'll go away. It'll just get worse. So he's saying people are changing their behavior, or the corporations are trying to change their behavior. Here we go.
LNG Canada project will come online, and there's a permitting done for phase two. But if we get more gas there, we could get it out. Nuclear is going to be a big part of this, something the government was originally opposed to, but they had to come around because you know what's happening, David? The facts can never be ignored. They just keep coming back. And now the government sees that. Same thing originally on carbon capture. Didn't want to capture it, now recognizes that we need to do it. We can do these things, but I've got to tell you, if we come at an emissions cap, if I were the Department of Finance, I would be extremely concerned. Now, we have a government that seems to have a little less worry about the fiscal framework, no more than happy to run deficit and debt, is now going to go after an industry that represents about 10% of our GDP.
He says they're creating a perfect storm. He says if we're not careful, but fundamentally, that's what they want. Like, that's the direction they want, a perfect storm where they can say, don't worry, the government will come in and fix it. The government will save you with the taxes that we've collected. Don't worry. And they want to be seen as the heroes, and they desperately don't want to talk about the fact that they've taken your money in the first place for nothing, for a redistribution scheme. That's it. Dan McTeague again responding to the National Post. The National Post is giving us an update on the snowmobiles, the electric snowmobiles. They say Quebec electric snowmobile maker Tiaga suspends production, says lays off 70 workers. And Dan McTeague says, hey, Seamus, can you remind us how much we lost on this virtue signaling grift you were a big part in promoting? So people are being lied to about electric snowmobiles, and our tax dollars are going to fund them, while at the same time, we can't afford the basics like food and rent, right? That's not good. And further than that, our tax dollars are going to fund foreign wars for nothing for Canadians. Holy smoke. Bernice says, at a clinic in Red Deer, people need to refuse this QR crap. Why are you tracking us, Danielle Smith? So here's... This is on just a clinic, a walk-in clinic. It says how the new QR code system works. Like, yes, we get a QR code for our healthcare system. Woo. One, a QR code will be posted on the door at 8 a.m. every morning. This code will remain up until the clinic is at capacity. Well, you know what to do, right? Like, go and take the QR, as many QR code pictures as you can. Fill up their capacity every single day. Use your cell phone with your camera on it. Hover over the QR code until the link pops up. Click on the link and follow the registration directions. Your Alberta health card is required. Once complete, you will see it. I'm not giving my health card number to a random link at a frickin' like walk-in clinic. Are you kidding me? No. Hard no. Thank you very much. Just to sign up for a spot in your line? No. Once you complete, you will see a check mark on your phone stating your registration was successful. Check with the receptionist at the front desk and they will give you your appointment time so you can come back. You have to give them your information, including your health card number, and then you have to go in and talk to the receptionist, and they'll say, oh yeah, we'll give you the time later, and I'll give it to you. No. If you're unable to register using the QR code, reception can assist you. So there you go. Skip everything else but number 7. Go to the reception. Holy smoke. It is scary how many people will just do the QR code. CBC Watcher says, let's talk about housing. In comments to a local NBC affiliate, City of Denver. So remember yesterday there was that person whose job it was to be the first point of contact for the migrants who were coming in. And he was saying, listen, we'll take you to Canada if you want, right? Now they've clarified that statement, okay? The City of Denver said it wasn't their policy to send migrants directly to Canadian cities, but they will distribute free bus tickets to U.S. stops that are close to the Canadian border if that's what the migrants want. What about what Canadians want? Here's Justin Trudeau building apartments, and iPolitics says Prime Minister Trudeau said the initiative is being called Canada Builds and is meant to turbocharge affordable apartment construction. I don't want to live in high-density slums. We don't want to live in high-density slums. Theo Fleury says, hey, everybody, we're building 15-minute cities with your tax dollars to enslave you. This is 2 minutes of Justin Trudeau. I don't know. I want to listen to him. Son of a Bench says Trudeau is creating another program, Canada Builds. This is a $15 billion program that includes low-interest construction loans and building rental housing units. The Liberals are looking to spend their way out of this mess that they have caused in Canada. So there's a whole bunch of other programs that they've announced. The Housing Accelerator Fund is one example, that haven't built anything. And now $15 billion more dollars? Are you calling GC Strategies to quarterback this house building, guys, or what? I mean, I don't trust these grifters, these liars, these thieves with $15 billion. I don't trust them with $5. Project YYC says 43 Calgary community associations signed a letter of opposition to blanket rezoning. Read the text and see the list of signatories at the link. Follow here for how to register to oppose City Hall's corrupt rezoning. And so here's the letter. It's brief. Dear Mayor Gondek, the proposal to blanket upzone the entire city is a significant change to our current planning policies and patterns of development. Density can benefit the city and communities if it's well planned. However, blanket upzoning creates density without regard for community context. We don't want to live in high-density slums. Housing choice already exists in Calgary. What's missing is deeply affordable non-market housing options. Blanket upzoning will not supply this. We respectfully request the creation of evidence-based policies tailored to address Calgary's specific needs and challenges that are co-designed with Calgarians. We, the undersigned communities, urge you to vote against the blanket upzoning and the public hearing schedule at the public hearing scheduled for April 22nd, 24. They're not going to change their vote. They're not. I'm sorry, they're not. I hope they do. I hope I'm wrong, but they're not going to change their vote. Why? Because they work for this guy here. This guy, this is in England, okay? Why doesn't the UK deport them all? This is an asylum seeker in the United Kingdom saying that he wants a house. He's been to too many hotels, and he's not going to move again. He wants a house. Here we go.
To people who say your accommodation is being paid for by the British taxpayer, yeah. So the government can send you to whichever hotel they want to.
I have been near to be 2 years. How can I move?
You're saying you're settled?
Yeah, yeah.
Man in the orange top from Sudan is the self-styled leader of this group of asylum seekers.
They feel angry every day.
Between them, they've all moved from two hotels in East London, where there were standoffs with the Home Office, refusing to leave before finally agreeing to be transferred to new accommodation an hour and a half away. They say they won't move to another hotel, let alone a barge.
If you get asked to move again to another hotel,
No. I can't move. I can't move. I will make protest. All the people here, I invite them to make protest in front of hotel.
This man from Sudan.
If the government tries to send you to a barge, what will be your reaction?
No, I don't want to go. I don't want to go anymore.
You say you don't want to go, but what will you do?
I go homeless.
By homeless.
You'll become homeless. Good solution. Get a job, find accommodation where you want to live. Nah, I'll be homeless. Okay then, maybe you could be homeless not in England. Globe and Mail says residents to return to Vancouver's homeless encampment after city clears the sites. Residents? Squatters, you mean? People who don't own the park because the park belongs to the taxpayers? Why are they being allowed to do this? I was saying yesterday, and I've said before, Canada should have, airports in Canada should have a hangar, and we can collect up people who are illegals, people who don't belong in the country, have not come here temporarily or anything like that. I'm talking about people who have just walked in and we don't know who they are, blah, 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 all that. Deport them. Put them in a hangar until there's a plane ready. Put them on the plane. Send them to the Middle East to, you know, have places that you're going to drop them off. Solve the problem. Deport them. And then make sure that Canadians who have been made homeless by these bad policies are helped with the tax dollars we're not sending to Ukraine anymore. How about that? Residents? These people are liars. Right? Here's Donald Trump. He says mass migration is destroying the country. You know, this is the first time I've heard him speak, and I thought to myself, he sounds old. Here we go. Here's Trump. I'm going to turn it down a bit. The mic's loud.
Stand before you today to declare the Joe Biden's border bloodbath, and that's what it is. It's a bloodbath. They tried to use that term incorrectly on me 2 weeks ago. You know, it's all about misinformation. That's all they do is cheat in elections and disinformation, misinformation, fairly closely related, those two words. But they basically mean that it's all talk. but it's a border bloodbath, and it's destroying our country. It's a very bad thing happening. It's going to end on the day that I take office, which will be January 20th. It'll end. But I still.
There you go. Are we going to have a 24 election? We'll see on April. Hello, everyone. Thanks very much for watching. This is just a short version of a longer show. If you'd like to get the whole show, you can go over to CanadaPoly.com and sign up for a subscription. Just look in the drop-down tab for Shop and Donate and look for subscriptions, and you'll get immediate access to the full show. Love to see you. Thanks for watching, everybody. Have a wonderful, wonderful day.